So far, since blinatumomab has been available, I've had one patient where they've had chemotherapy refractory disease and gave blinatumomab and did not go to transplant. That was after a very lengthy discussion about the risks and the benefits, and the patient ultimately decided didn't want to do a transplant. I'm curious, has anybody else here done that so far?
So the question would be, again, if you, I mean, if you probably have a fully matched, either sibling donor, unrelated donor, you may lean to go, and the patient is fully fit, young, you may go to transplant. Somebody who doesn't have a fully matched donor, that sort of patient, you may just continue with the blinatumomab and see what their long-term outcome is.
Yeah. I mean, again, the decision to go to transplant is not always simply based on availability of the donor and the medical scenario. We find that the social support for that patient is critically important, and there are patients that we cannot transplant because they lack adequate social support. And that exact scenario has happened. I wanted to allograft a patient, just wasn't going to work socially. Five cycles of blinatumomab, and you know, 2 years later, still in remission. So, you know, again, that data is, you know, those experiences, those anecdotes that recapitulate the BLAST study data are very compelling. But we need a larger experience to ever sit back and say, okay, we're done. Because it feels very uncomfortable to leave those patients without additional therapy of some kind.
Ryan, would you ever use inotuzumab in this setting?
I would consider it. I think because while blinatumomab tends to be, at least in my practice, well tolerated, particularly in patients with low burden disease and it's highly active, not all patients are going to be willing to do blinatumomab, or it's just feasibly not possible. So for example, where I practice, we have a catchment area that includes Alaska and Montana and places like this that blinatumomab is not something that they're comfortable doing in these smaller communities that don't see a lot of these patients. So I would certainly favor, again, it's a bit of an extrapolation, but that's chemotherapy refractory disease. We know from the INNOVATE study published in the New England Journal of Medicine that inotuzumab is superior to standard of care salvage chemotherapy. So you could argue that in that scenario, inotuzumab is probably going to be more effective at eliminating the residual disease than...
Bit of a jump, though, right? Because there's no data for treating MRD with inotuzumab.
That is true.
And, inotuzumab is technically not an immunotherapy. I mean, it's chemotherapy. You're delivering it in a specified way, getting more chemo into the cells. And I think that's why it has better activity than salvage chemotherapy. But I don't think we have any data to guide us to use inotuzumab in the MRD setting.
So what would you, in someone who can't get blinatumomab, that's, you know, B-cell ALL, but can't get blinatumomab in that scenario, I'm curious, what would you do?
I'd lose sleep over it because I don't know. I probably, then maybe I would give them inotuzumab because there are no other great options.
Right.
You know, sometimes I will do high-dose methotrexate, or in the past I have. If they haven't had PEG asparaginase before because maybe they were treated on a hyper-CVAD regimen, I'm definitely going to get some PEG into that patient before they go to transplant.
I'm glad you hit on that because I think it ties in nicely to the concept of T-ALL. We've been very focused on B-ALL. And actually, that is exactly what I do, is I'll add asparaginase to the hyper-CVAD backbone, kind of based off the augmented hyper-CVAD study that was published a few years back, as a way of trying to mitigate that MRD. We initially were using nilarabine on the hyper-CVAD backbone, and particularly for those higher risk early thymic precursor ALLs, we weren't seeing the activity that we wanted. In contrast, with the asparaginase, we're seeing a little bit more in the way of responses and durable responses. The goal is still allo for me. And this is the hard part about the inno, is how do I get them to the allo, because we're talking about first remission now, so with the goal of first remission, how do I get them to the allo? Because I know they're chemo refractory, I've had to use an agent to get them there. How long am I going to wait after the inno to take them to the allo? Is it really just the double alkylators that are going to be the risk, or is it if I give them a, you know, a TBI based or even a Buflu based allo transplant? What risks is am I exposing my patient to?
Yeah. Well, the Anderson data regarding inotuzumab and VOD suggests it's not just the use of double alkylators at the time of conditioning, but it's also age over 55, any abnormality in the bilirubin at the initiation of conditioning, and the number of exposures to inotuzumab. So, you know, if we were put into that scenario where all we had to bridge our MRD-positive patient to transplant, hopefully you would use a minimal amount of inotuzumab to achieve that MRD-negative status. Again, we don't know in the absence of any prospective data whether that's actually going to augment the outcome of the transplant. But at the very least, if you can minimize the exposure to INO going into the transplant, hopefully we can mitigate some of those risks of VOD. And one of the things that I've heard that as a transplanter makes me a little bit frustrated is some people say, well, you don't have to worry about VOD anymore because defibrotide has been approved. And that's just simply not true. The case fatality rate for VOD, even with defibrotide, is still 30 to 40%. So, you know, transplanters hate VOD. That is something I lose sleep over. If I have a patient and looks like they're developing VOD, I'm really, really worried about that patient, even if I have them on defibrotide. We don't know yet whether defibrotide can mitigate the risk of VOD that is caused by a calicheamycin conjugate prior to transplant, or whether it could, for instance, be used prophylactically. These are really interesting questions that I think we can address. You know, for instance, is there something we can do during inotuzumab therapy to mitigate subsequent risk of VOD? These are really important questions that we need to answer.